pleasure of meeting Natella about 2-3 weeks ago for the first time. We came across her kind of incidentally, but evidently other people have known her for some time, so I'm very glad to make your acquaintance. Natella is from Armenia. She moved abroad in Israel and studied for a number of years at the Ben Gurion University in Negev, Israel. She got her PhD, then she did her postdoc in the University of Maryland and the Weizmann Institute, which, from what I understand, the Weizmann Institute, she did not apply. They invited her, which is even more impressive. Then she decided her homeland needs her. Is that how it is? No, I don't know. She came back to Armenia, and it is our pleasure to have her here. She did many topics about which on water issues that she can talk about. We decided to leave it up to her to decide which topic she would like to present to us. And I hope that this will be the beginning of a relationship between us and Natella going forward. And we're open to many opportunities and possibilities. Natella, thank you very much for taking this time and look forward to your talk.
Thank you, sir. I must say this is my first talk in Armenia ever, in English. Today I will try to present some data from my PhD studies and my first paper from Maryland. And also during my PhD studies, apparently I established myself as someone who works with solid waste in aquaculture facilities, so I also ended up being involved in other students' projects. And I'll try to give you a peek of how we can holistically approach agricultural business, or most importantly, aquacultural business, and how we can try to make a sustainable system, a system that doesn't need to pollute the environment and doesn't need actually to take from the environment at all. And this all started, I just want to show you some data from World Forestry Agriculture Organization 2014. And okay, here, you can see. This is the first graph, and it shows basically how much fish was captured from 1950s till last year's, from different fishery stuff. Okay, maybe the pointer is okay. And the upper part, actually, you can see how much fish was produced from aquaculture production. And you can see here, there's kind of a plateau in fishing. It means that because of environmental regulations, and also we deplete most of the fisheries, we stop fishing much, and we start growing the fish in aquaculture. The second graph is actually talking about aquaculture, again about fish aquaculture. I will tell you later, aquaculture is a bit bigger than only fish production. But here it's about aquaculture, and we can see that most of the fish today is produced in inland operations. There is a lot of mariculture still, but it is mostly moving towards the inland aquaculture because of sustainability. This picture is actually fishing of tuna. And here this is the picture of the University of Maryland experimental facilities. And I kind of wanted to show it to you. You see these tanks? Basically the man on the edge, this is Yoni Zohar. He was the head of the institute when I joined them. And Yoni is really specialized in recirculating aquaculture systems. And he's really, really, really excited about new options. And these beautiful tanks are the tanks where he is currently growing this tuna. Like, you don't need to buy to fish anymore for tuna. They are growing. Unfortunately, in the experimental facilities, you are not allowed to take pictures. So most of the pictures are either blurry, or you don't see the fish, or you don't see the entire system. I also have to say that this system is actually in the basement of the building. The building is smaller than this one. There's kind of a square basement, and the entire basement is producing fish or sharks or blue crabs, and all is recirculating, and all is very clean and pure. And actually in the system that I worked with for 2 years, the last produce was like 4 tons of fish. And now there is no market, and they sold it to the restaurants around the institute. So a few words about aquaculture. I know most of the things in the introduction I say will be elementary for you, but I didn't know the audience. So basically in aquaculture you don't need to grow only fish, you can grow blue crabs, and this is oysters. The institute that I joined in my postdoc and part of my PhD I did there, they actually restored the dying population of these blue crabs. This is the picture from Baltimore. They restored there was almost no blue crabs there. And they restored it, and now you have a lot of blue crabs, and the price is good, and situation is really good, simply because one institution for 5 years worked on the problem. So we can grow these animals in different salinity waters, freshwater, brackish water, and saltwater. And of course, the easiest way is the freshwater, but it's expensive, and not every country has the Armenian capabilities with freshwater. So generally the trend is to grow fish in brackish water or salt water, and this is also scientifically very challenging because you try to adapt generations of fish that like fresh water to grow in salty water. And there was a project in this basement one like that with cobia. And then you have different temperatures, and again for a farmer it's useful to grow cold water fish because he doesn't need to invest his money on heating the water. And of course there is an intensification, different intensification of the system. Some systems are really, really neutral. Some are extensive, some are intensive. And in this list is from FAO 2014, the most intensive is apparently raceway systems and cage systems. But if you look at the list, there is nothing about recirculating aquaculture fish systems. And when I dug a bit, I found that this graph is from a publication from 1998, which is the time that this recirculating system just came as new systems and people started to use. So just a few things about environmental sustainability. First is the cage system. These are basically like net cages, and these are always offshore. I don't know why in this picture it's not offshore, but I keep it. So you put the net in the water, in the marine environment, and then you grow fish. And it's really good, it's very intense, and the water changes itself and you do nothing. But a lot of research showed that when you grow these stocks of fish and it's very intense, all this garbage goes to the water. And lately there was a research from Hebrew University, and they showed that this carbon with global warming does something really terrible for the Red Sea. The second system is the pond system. This is just pond, earthen pond, and it's very, very easy to grow, but it's very hard to keep the water clean. And also the garbage collects, the waste collects, and after a while you should dry the pond, clean the waste, and start from the zero. Then you have raceway systems. This is like a system that the water flows through. And these systems are really clean and quite intensive. And when the water gets out of these systems and you stand by, you don't see any contamination or pollution or solids. But in reality, if you collect it and you take away the dilution factor, it's a big, big source of pollution. And this is the indoor tanks, which is exactly the systems that we had in Baltimore and also in Israel. And these are very, very sustainable systems, and I'll talk about this. These systems are generally being recirculating, and which basically means that you have two basins where you grow your fish. And from that, something very important that happens here is that they collect the solid waste. These are the first systems actually in the market and in the industry that would have different kind of filters, there are many types, and they would collect the waste, now solid waste, which is very important because up to 50% of the fish waste here will end up as solid waste. Fish feed will end up as solid waste. What is also very important that you grow a lot of fish here. If you really see the operations, the fish are so dense, they actually would jump out to have air. So it's a small place, but a lot of waste, and then,
when
you know...
you say waste removal, is it, you're going to explain how you remove the waste?
I can answer the questions. Here is basically, there are different kind of filters, mostly drum filters, and they get this waste, and then I'll tell you what they do with it, what they did with it before my PhD. And then you have CO2 striper and whatever, and then you have another waste treatment, which is very important. This is here. Here, these three basins, or it can be three different reactors, it can be even one reactor, it actually would remove nitrogenous waste. It would make ammonium to NO3, NO3 to molecular nitrogen, and then would go to whatever atmosphere, and it would clean. Now, what's interesting here is that it's never a clean 100% process, and you basically would have up to 50% of water exchange in these systems with the environment. Also, this solid waste, you have to wash it out. So you throw like 15% of water too. And what's interesting also here, I put a couple of numbers just for myself. 40 to 66% of fish feed would end up as ammonia, which is very toxic to fish, has to get, like the farmer has to get rid of it first. There is nothing that kills fish quicker than the ammonia. And it's produced all the time because of the breeding. And what's interesting also in recirculating systems, and I already told you about it, there is a huge tendency of moving towards more salty water because the farmers cannot buy fresh water, they don't have it. And this is in 2000, basically almost, the brackish water, which is in between fresh and salty, they actually show the biggest, highest growth rates. It's not still the highest production, but it grows very fast. So when I came to my PhD topic, and it was very accidental that I ended up with this, the first thing when my boss told me, he said, tomorrow 4 o'clock in the morning we are going to the field. And we went to the field to see what the aquaculture facilities, recirculating aquaculture facilities do with their solid waste. And you can see the pictures here. This is a farm and you can see how green this is. This is eutrophication. And actually we warned the manager a few times and fish died. He didn't actually bother to clean it. This farmer was much more environmentally friendly. So he had, when I started my PhD, 1 pond for wastewater treatment. When I finished 4, already 4th pond was there. So he basically would fill the pond with sludge. You can see how it looks, how dense it is. This is a concentrated sludge. And basically this should be aerated. And this is the aerator, but he had only 1 aerator for the entire pond. And these both systems were really stinky, like, I don't know, a few kilometers from the aquaculture facilities, you would feel it. Here you would feel the sulfide, here you would feel all kind of different mixes. So generally what people do with this solid waste is land application. They would just put it on the land and then they would use it in a sludge lagoons like here. And like in Baltimore, they would throw it to the municipal system. But municipal systems weren't very happy with it, and there were always the complaints that they changed the general characteristics of the wastewater, and municipal systems are more or less in the range of the waste quality that they treat. And so here, this guy, he had a really intense production, and he would actually treat his water, and when the sludge would sit, he would pump the water, and on the background you can see olive trees. So he would grow olive trees on this water, which are perfect because olive trees are salt tolerant, but they don't use the salt. So eventually, after a few years, he couldn't grow anything because the soil was completely salinized. And there was a lot of microbial contamination, and of course from here you have all the greenhouse production possible. I understand that compared to, I don't know, oceans and stuff, maybe this is not much, but it's a lot for a little country like Israel. And the most important thing was the fertilization. Basically, you put a lot of phosphorus, nitrogen, carbon in this pond, 1 rain, and then it's all over countries, and the groundwaters were contaminated, basically. So this is my shoe, by the way. This is the sampling I was doing every Wednesday, and it smells the way, like, for 2 weeks you cannot eat. It's just absolutely terrible. It, like, poisons you, and people live around it. This is the problem. So the first thing we did, we characterized the sludge. Here is the picture of my boss, Amit, from PhD times, and I showed the pictures of people who did the projects with me because they had to get the credit. And we did the complete characterization of this sludge from many, many, many different facilities. I want to show you basically the amount of nitrogen, which is quite high even for the system that actually has to remove it. There is a lot of phosphorus here, and you see the numbers are quite different, three times almost, depends on the system. And there's a lot of carbon here. And because these systems are so rich, then I again told you when they throw it, it brings the problem of fertilization. And these are real life pictures. This is what happened when there was an oyster farm next to the river or whatever it was. They grew the oyster farm and they threw the waste to the river. It's a river, what would happen? And eventually one day they woke up and all the river fish are dead because there was a fertilization, eutrophication, and anoxic conditions. This is the, I think, catfish farm or carp. And you see how green the water is, even if they are trying to treat it. And this green is basically meaning that tomorrow the fish will look exactly like this. This is one of the biggest problems with global warming. We don't want to face it generally, and it happens naturally, and now we make it with aquaculture. And there was this publication from 2000, very controversial, but I tend to believe it after seeing the pictures, that if you grow 100 tons of salmon, you produce waste equal like a small town, like a small town of people pumping their waste into the river daily or whatever it is. So we decided to come up with a solution, and the biggest and most important solution was to remove the solids. If we could get good water quality and also produce biogas, that would be good. Because one thing that is very important for a farmer, he doesn't want to invest in labor, he doesn't want to invest in money, and he wants something from it. In Israel, most of these productions are in the desert. So it's a waste area, nobody uses it, used it. Now they started putting some settlements there, people live there. But all in all, you have to interest the farmer. And we decided to interest the farmer firstly with the land requirements, so he wouldn't make these huge ponds, which is a lot of land, and which cannot be used after all for anything at all, and maybe produce biogas. So here we looked at the, I looked at the characteristics of the sludge, and there's a lot of BOD there, and carbon to nitrogen ratio is quite okay, and total suspended solids are little. This is kind of a diluted waste. And it's good actually. If you need to make a bioreactor and you have to pump it, it's really good that it has a lot of water, but we figured out that the cheapest and most convenient way of doing this biogas production and waste treatment is the UASB reactors, which are upflow anaerobic sludge blanket reactors. These reactors are really good for low total solid concentration, and it's actually, you actually don't need any labor other than maybe once a year opening it up and cleaning the, removing the rest of the solids. I tried it once in a university full system with students. We actually didn't find solids. Like, it was a waste of 2 days' time to stop everything because there was no solids. But basically, if you have to pump your sludge to the pond, you basically pump your sludge into the reactor. The same money, even cheaper maybe. And the sludge settles. It settles itself, and the moment it starts making biogas, it's anaerobic condition, it floats. It goes up and down, up and down. In certain point, it sits again, and now you have little particles, granules, that go up and down. And they're really pretty from my point of view, because it's kind of a mud, but you have this little bubble of biogas, and it looks like pearl. It looks really pretty from my point of view again. So the bottom part is sludge, and every time you pump a sludge, it goes up and down, so it mixes. You don't need electricity to move, mix. And this is important because you can literally clean anything now if you have enough money to get a good system. Everything is cleanable, even pharmaceuticals. But the investment, financial investment, nobody wants to do it. Even municipalities don't do that. So the upper part will be the water. We have solids, water, and then, you know, we have this inverted cone, and then we would have a biogas production. And we started doing it. First thing you do is in the laboratory, and this is my bench scale experiment. Now, when you go to the farmer and you say, I want this system, he says, you know, sometimes I produce a bit too much NO3 because my system is not working. And sometimes I produce a bit too much NO2. And this is important because as long as the concentration of NO2, NO3 is lower than the one that will kill the fish, it will happen. And he wants something robust from you. And the other problem here was the salt. There is sulfate, and sulfates are inhibitory for methanogenesis, known forever. I don't remember if it was ever some news. So we took this sludge and we put them in the anaerobic bottles. And you can see here, these are, you see the bubbles, these are the biogas. And you actually invert it because otherwise your cup will jump out if you forgot to release the pressure. And what we saw is that from the day 2 to day 28, if we don't touch anything, we have biogas production, and we have, which means already digested sludge. And we also saw that in some cases it starts late, but there is quite a lot of biogas production. And here I want to show the picture here. And this is the concentration of methane, not the total amount of biogas produced. And you can see that the sludge is called raw because we didn't touch anything. We just took the sludge, put it in the bottle, didn't change. Here we played around. We added nitrogen this way, nitrogen that way, we suppressed sulfate reduction. But long story short, we had really, really, really good digestibility. And we also could show here that sulfate did nothing in this case if, and this was important because I had to acclimatize my microbiology before starting it. If I didn't do it, I would see problems with sulfate. So we went to this farmer, he was a really cool guy, and he was Tel Avivian who was somehow working in this desert, and he kept his Tel Avivian aura. And we showed him these bottles and graphs, and he said, oh, so let's do it. And we went and made a lab-scale reactor. I'm not an engineer. I can work with any reactor, do the chemistry, microbiology. I don't do engineering much. Now the farmer said, can I basically do it quickly? Like, I don't want to wait 28 days. So we constructed four of these reactors. It's dark because if it's light, you have algae growing in it. But this part is open. Like, I can open and see it's a window. And there are three ports for the liquid removal. And this is also something that comes with an experience because the sludge floats. If you have your eluent removal port here, the first week you pump sludge, which was a big disaster in Baltimore because they made only one port. And here we have here the feeding, here the tubing comes, and we have this cylinder to grow to collect the biogas. And what we can see here is this is my input volatile solids. And with time, the reactors work better and better and better. And you have really, really like little amount of volatile solids. You see this slope is like decreasing. And over time, I did this experiment for 361 days or whatever. And I had different hydraulic retention times, different temperatures, different carbon to nitrogen ratio. The only problem during this experiment was that something kept in with the waste filters. So we had a very, very liquid waste, like the total solids were like invisible more or less. But after like 12 months of operation, we could remove up to 99.6%, like almost all sludge. We would like really end up with a handful of sludge, and because we didn't know what to do with it, we dried it in 65 degrees Celsius and put them in the little boxes, and I guess it's still in the lab somewhere there. But in all conditions, we really removed almost all the sludge. And we produced a lot of water. And this water amount of water is depends how much you feed your reactor, right? Because it's replaced. So 2 liters, the 2 liters will come out. You have to be very, I have to tie this here. You have to be very careful about this. Basically here, we had only ammonia, which is a product of anaerobic digestion, but in aquaculture facility, you treat ammonia anyway, so it's okay. And we were very worried about the sulfide. That is kind of on the limit of what you give to your fish. Aquaculture facilities generally have sulfide also. Not very high concentration, but they always have because it's food inside the water digests. But then, because this whole water would go to one more time to this ammonia oxidation reactor, we actually had absolutely no problem with recycling this water. And basically, the only problem this time we had, and I knew that would happen, was the biogas issue, because in this case, the solids were so low that would only maintain the microbial population and they would not produce much biogas. But later on in the pilot experiments, we produced a lot of biogas, and I will just show you some mass balance and then I'll show you in the systems. After 4 years of my work, what we could do is actually we would reclaim this big system that I showed. 17% of water would go back to the system. And instead of producing 22 tons of solids in a year, we produce 2 tons. Which means even if this guy is going to put it in these ponds, it will like, instead of 10 ponds, he will need one. Also, these solids are really, they are really digested and they are dark and they look like charcoal a bit. So you can actually use them for fertilizer. I don't know if the salinity wouldn't bother them. We decided that at that point I was finishing my PhD. So we advised him to start concentrating his solids, and basically there is almost no solids produced here. And during this time I was giving many talks And this was very interesting for people. And then they came and started asking me, like, so how do you compare your system with this open system? And now as a scientist, it's really, really hard to compare it. Like, how do I know what is this system producing? I can do another PhD and do it, but I don't have time. And so it took us for a while to figure out the very interesting solution. But basically, we took bags, Dacron bags that are permeable for water. We put the solids and we hang them one in a reactor, one in the pond. And then over time, we check the organic matter. And as we were suspecting, these ponds, because there's a lot of oxygen and it's open, it would actually become more. The solids will become more because microbes grow, microbes die, and they are solids, basically. And also here, you would have all your greenhouse gases captured. Here it goes all to the environment. And this wouldn't salinize, this will salinize. And basically, we could kind of prove that our system can be, if from my point of view, it's intuitive. But we had to prove, and we proved, and we published a paper in 2012 about this. And these are two examples of the pilot studies. This is the experimental facility in Ben Gurion University. One of my PhD supervisors is an aquaculture guy, and he works with the endocrine system of fish. And he has this really cool interdisciplinary team of guys. I think I was the only woman in the history of these teams. And each guy does something. Two are engineers, one is a fish biologist, one is this and one is that. And they all together grow or work on this facility. And most of the facility is new. Like this is the denitrifying reactor where they actually used cotton instead of external carbon to denitrify, and they were very successful. And this is the sludge settler, and from here the waste will go to this anaerobic reactor, or this is the reactor. And unfortunately I lost the source file, but there are some crazy videos. These guys at night trying to burn the biogas from this thing, and it actually explodes. And they sent me this picture as like, see what we did. But like, all of us were going to lose our jobs if this was happening again. So here is a more polite picture. You see they have Bunsen burner, and you actually are always treated cup of coffee when you go there, made on this biogas produced in the system. And this system was actually working 8 months. I went to help them to clean, and there was no solids inside. Actually, we tried to do mass balance. It ended up being negative, which is like funny. We never published it, of course. This is the system in Baltimore. Again, it's a basement. It's a literally basement of the building. They grew sea bream a lot. And you can see there's a huge anaerobic reactor here. And if you see in the reactor, basically here, you don't see much solids because all solids are gone. And the guy who worked here, he actually kind of made electricity from it. This is more visual, but this is like what he made. And he would cover 15% of his system's energy demands by this waste. The only thing that happened problematic here, because you have too much sulfate, this is 16 ppt salinity. The one in Israel was 2 to 4. We had a lot of sulfide produced. So the liquid that came from this had a lot of sulfide. And we didn't know, they didn't know what to do. And by this time, I finished my PhD, and I was moving to Belgium to do postdoc on biogas production. And the head of this lab that I visited on and off during my PhD, he called me and said, can you come and do a postdoc with us? And I moved to Baltimore instead of Belgium. And that was a problem because they wanted to do something with this sulfide. And the whole idea is this Baltimore thing. I actually like this ambition that people have there, is the whole institute working on fish, and they really, really try to be sustainable, like 100% sustainable. So I moved there, started my PhD, and the first thing I tried to check, like, okay, what if we throw this sulfide pool water to the water? Now, the interesting thing is in Baltimore, this institute sits on the water. It's a channel from this side, channel from this side, and the bay. You basically, if you are drunk after your work, you'll fall in the water, literally. I mean, that's so, the cars crash in the water. So it's really easy to throw this to the water, but this is what can happen. This is like fish mortalities, crabs mortalities, this is starfish mortalities. And this now happens in the planet a lot, because we have this eutrophication as a global warming result. And these are like kind of a lot of reports, and I worked on this in Weizmann more or less, and I will not talk about it, but this is what we don't want to have. So again, I went to Baltimore, and the grant was already like on for 6 months, and nothing was basically done. And here we produced a lot of sulfide. But then here we have nitrogen cycle, and we came up with this idea, what if we couple these two cycles? And I'll tell you how. So these are reactors that you use for nitrogen removal in aquaculture facilities. This is not something new, like it's done for 20, 30, 40 years. These reactors have these plastic beads, and the microbes basically get attached to it, and they do two processes dependent on reactor. First places they would oxidize ammonium to NO3, and this is autotrophic. You don't need to give it anything. You just have, you need air. CO2 is good enough for them. And then when you make this NO3, you send it to a different reactor like this, and here you have to give them extra carbon source, which is quite expensive. It takes a good dosing. But it's also done very, very, very well. Like everybody does it, and they make molecular nitrogen. And if you see, if 66% of fish feed is ending up with this ammonium, you can imagine how much NO3 we produce there. And this is heterotrophic way of removing NO3, which is used. But we already know that in the nature there was another way of removing NO3, which is autotrophic. And I once talked to a professor from Zurich, and she said, I think if there is any two chemicals in the environment, the microbe can use them simultaneously. She said, we just cannot pick up the right moment to see this. And this was more or less right, because instead of this carbon source, if we have actually sulfide that we already have, and that was the whole problem, we can actually use the sulfide NO3 and NO3 to end up with SO4, which is exactly what we have in our water. We add it in the water because it's a tough water in Baltimore, and get rid of NO3. Now, this process is a very slow process, and it's also a very dangerous process. Generally, if you want a repeatable results for your PhD, you don't work with sulfide. It's a rule of thumb. Like, if you don't want to finish a degree, then you can be interested in sulfide. Sulfide is like absolutely crazy compound, and it makes so much intermediate products, and it's just like, you can never make a mass balance. That's the first thing I learned when I was working with those. This is my boss in Baltimore, Professor Harold Schreier. He actually found the anamox in aquaculture facilities the first time. And I'm not going to, it's a 2-year work of microbiology, but what we did is we had to figure out if we have enough sulfate reducing bacteria and enough sulfide oxidizing bacteria, and if these sulfide oxidizing bacteria are the ones that we can use. Like here, you see pink media, that means it's anaerobic media. If it's pink, it has oxygen, and here there is no oxygen, and this is when I grew my sulfide oxidizing bacteria. In the time when, just from the water, I didn't even get the sulfidic environment. Here is opposite. You have anaerobic media that has no color. You put the sulfate reducing bacteria there, they make sulfide. Sulfide connects with the iron, and it makes this black residue here. So we, and then, you know, we did a lot of DGG cloning, I'm not going to talk about it. But basically, we had a microbiota that could support both processes. And again, we went to the lab and did a bunch of experiments. This is my control group, it just is killed, autoclaved. And here I added, we simulated more or less what happened in the system. We had a big bunch of nitrogen one time, but because it comes from ammonia oxidation reactor, it comes one time but a lot, but sulfide can come all the time. And so we gave different concentration of sulfide, and here you see everything is nice, here it's already a bit yellow, it means that our sulfide is becoming elemental sulfur. Here it's really yellow, it's a polysulfide basically, it means that part of our sulfide is there and it's really, really dangerous. But what we could figure out here, that if we take 1-to-1 ratio, everything is absolutely perfect and it works. If we accidentally go high, we will have some other products, which also can happen in your system. Interestingly enough, in this case, even we have other product, all the sulfide is gone, which is absolutely amazing and is good. It's just the end product is different. But we wanted to see the robustness. And to see the robustness, we just checked all the microbiology. This is the DGG gel. Each line is representing a microbial type. That's all I want to say. And what we could see is that even if there is a free sulfide there, like, nothing happens. And if you don't have sulfide in your system, then your microbes will do their heterotrophic denitrification. They just don't die. They are sitting there, maybe not active, but they sit there. And of course, the microbiology that I wanted was there. And so we actually started implementing this system of autotrophic denitrification. So all the sulfide that was produced from aquaculture facility would go to this reactor. and would end up reacting with nitrate. This is the slide that I stole from her, my boss, that's why I didn't change the fonts. So you know it's his slide. Here we start growing fish slowly. Here is the maximum growth of fish. It's a cibrium production. This red is the input of nitrate. And this is output of nitrogen. This is nitrate nitrogen, this is just nitrogen. And here we have sulfide. The red is input and the green is output. We actually virtually got rid of all sulfide in the system. And it never smelled actually. And this is the masterpiece of this University of Maryland Institute. I very much like it. So this is a recirculating aquaculture system. It's called 100% water reuse. I'm not 100% sure that it's 100%, but it's closer to 90 whatever. So we grow the fish, we move the solids. Very solids stay here a bit before going to reactor, make sulfide. Sulfide goes and reacts to nitrate. The rest of solids go and make biogas. Nitrate can come back basically, and nitrogen. But if there's leftovers, it will come back and react like ammonia in an oxic environment and goes back to the fish. And I was listening an interview with the head of the institute, current head that I don't know, and he was telling that in their system, it's for 1 year they didn't change the water and they didn't add the water. Which is, I hope, true, and there is nothing going out to the environment. The other thing is that is important to tell here, it's good to reuse your water, but we have to also understand that this is not only pollution that is there. Like sometimes fish will, what is fish food? It's fish, it's the marine fish, the small ones, they, you know, catch it, I don't know, dry it or whatever, and whatever garbage we have in oceans ends up in aquaculture facilities. So here there are other researchers that work on this problems as well, and I will show a little example on it. And so basically it's here. This is another three slides, no more. This is another project during my PhD studies, Sharon Fox, I hope he's already a doctor. He joined our lab as a master's student, and since I was the only one who was working with the wastewater treatment, I ended up working with him a lot. And as a master's student, you want to give him a project that is kind of a bit new, but not really challenging. He has 2 years, he has to finish and he has to continue. And Shalom had this really interesting project. There is this city in Israel, Haifa. It's actually on the Mediterranean. It's quite Arabic. It's the only city that has Christmas tree in Israel. It's a Christian Arabs, and it's really like industrial, like really industrial and really dirty, absolutely, like nobody cares. And they grow, there is this company there, Gedot. And Gedot is a chemical production that makes a lot of food preservatives and phosphates and minerals. It just produces. It sits on the beach, literally, and it has this huge tubing and it throws the water in the field. And Sharon had this idea that why we wouldn't try to remove, there's also aquaculture in Haifa, of course, and he had this idea why we wouldn't try to remove the carbonous waste with our aquaculture nitrogen waste. It's simple, there is nothing new. He will do the thesis, he will do the modeling, Shalom was a modeling guy, and he will end up with his thesis. And this waste from this company, like, it's a water, but it has 35% of citrate in it. It's a lot of citrate, it's an organic compound, it's carbon, it's really bad for this Haifa Bay, basically. And Shalom constructed himself a continuously steered tank reactor. This is a reactor that has also like a kind of a propeller arms, and it moves, so it mixes. And because it mixes, the efficiency is really high. The farmers don't like it because they have to invest in electricity. But he moved a pump from one side, this NO3, and from the other side, this citrate waste, and it was a long work. And he eventually, what he did was he removed 98% of the solids. And instead of 83 tons of this citrate produced from this one company a year, we ended up with like 10 tons. It's like 8 times less. It's again a pollution. It has to still be taken care of, but it is so much, much better than what it was. And then by the end, when I second time returned back to Israel, he called me and he said, listen, I cannot write this paper. He wanted to publish, he started a PhD, and he said, it's not that exciting for me. And I asked him, like, maybe you can send me the raw data. And he sent me data, like this graph was 8 pages of data, of like 5 columns. What happened was, because you throw whatever you treat, it still goes to the environment, the water, you check the heavy metals and phosphorus inside it. And then we accidentally, very much, and thanks to the reviewers who didn't accept the paper a couple of times before, we found that in this system, the sludge would mobilize all the phosphorus, zinc, and plumbum. What is it now?
Lead.
So you see these last parts are solids, and solids actually has this. Again, understand me correctly, it's there. It's not gone, but it's in these 10 tons instead of 83 tons. It's much little amount. It's enough as it's not in the water. You can deal with this. You can at least hide it if you don't want to throw it to the environment. The other thing we noticed was, if you see this plumbum lead data, there is only 3 bars, the others are 4. Because the company, when they gave us the characteristics of their solids, they said there is no lead in it. And apparently there was a lot of lead in it. Just like somehow either they intentionally or not intentionally did it. And now, shall we move to a completely different topic, desalination, but Amit is actually working on this topic and basically trying to come up with a system, and I suggested him some stuff, and he has his ideas, of course, that could actually, this is intrinsic microbiology, you don't do anything. So if you do something on this thing that already cleans the heavy metals, you can actually come up with a system that can be used in a different industries, not only in aquaculture. And this is the last slide, but I have to tell it. This is again University of Maryland. You see the blue things, these are the actually fish tanks. This is Al Place professor, and it's his PhD student, Erin, who was many years constantly the best PhD student in aquaculture in the States. They had this really super cooper idea. They decided that since the fish is eating fish, which is already contaminated, maybe we should grow a fish who doesn't eat fish. And they started giving fish a vegetarian diet, mostly soy food and many different compositions of oils from stove. And actually they made to the news, which is like UM researchers developed plant-based fish feed to ease pressure on world's fisheries. And they were really successful, other than canola oil. Apparently canola oil is very toxic, not only to fish, but to people, and we eat it here in Armenia a lot. And they grew cobia. And this is another experiment that I didn't talk about. Cobia doesn't like living in captivity, and it doesn't like salty water, and they actually managed growing it. But this is the water they had. And now this weed water has to go to the denitrification reactor, but it has a lot of oil, and oil is not good. And after a few months of work, and I cannot talk much about this because eventually when we found this, it stopped being my project, but we kind of could isolate 2 microbes that were oil degrading. This is again interesting microbiology. We didn't do anything. This was by the time I was finishing my postdoc, moving back to Armenia again. And we came up with this idea that we have to try to bio-augment these microbes. Basically give them more and more and more and more oil until most of microbiology is oil degrading. And then this could be actually used to degrade any like restaurant waste or whatever. The oil is a big pollutant also because it's really hard to remove. And this is where I finish. But entirely what I wanted today to show, not only that what we did and here and there, that you can actually approach the agribusiness or any kind of business as a potentially sustainable thing. And you can actually work hard, but from different directions, to make a system that doesn't pollute. And this is hard, and there is never ever, from my point of view, 100% sustainable systems. There will be still investments, there will be still work needed, but it is possible to ease the pressure on the environment in a very, very large values from my point of view. And it's also what I learned during these studies, personally, that the environment is very complex. Generally, when you talk to people and say, I found this microbe and I do this, you always have to think, what is the next step? Okay, what is the leftovers of your microbes in the environment? Because generally, if we got rid of the solid waste, we get suicide. And the question is, like, what's worse? You also don't know. So it's very important to look at this situation in a more interdisciplinary way and think about it. And this system in Baltimore, that is, if anyone is there, could go and visit, but no pictures. It's possible, and we can actually live in a sustainable world and with sustainable production. And the system I worked on, I told you, grew 4 tons. There are like four, I don't know, like this table, if it was round, it's more or less the size of the tank, in four tree tanks. In tree tanks, we grew 4 tons of seedling. And no garbage to environment and no water exchange. And we have to do something with this fish, and we are a scientific institution, and we all ate fish constantly. Like, you always get fish as a present from some professor. But this is what happened at the end, a couple of restaurants in the Bay Area. This is the fish we grow, literally. It's, and this is from the article, and the restaurants would buy this fish because it was cheap and it was fresh. It was literally like 100 meters from restaurant grown, and it wasn't coming from Europe, and it had no heavy metals or whatever toxins because it was grown on a vegetarian diet. And this, it was vegetarian fish, literally. And the ones in Canada didn't grow. It's just they kind of would stay small, they wouldn't die, but they never grew. And this is it, and thank you very much.
I'm not going to pretend I understood half of this, okay? So, because all the microbiology flew straight over my head. My background is more the environmental economics and resource economics stuff. So, when you asked what's the next step, I understand from your scientific perspective, what's the next micro? For me, what's the next step is how do we turn this into the industry and how does it work in the real life? I think what was very precious for me in your presentation is that you've actually worked with real aqua farmers, and there were practical cases. It didn't just happen in laboratory, sterile, you know, theoretical conditions. There's probably a huge, like a zillion kilometer leap between that and what happens in Armenia. Now, since you're back and amazing, how do we make the transition from this to what our aquaculture does? We had a presentation earlier from students today. I had no idea. Basically, agriculture is now competing with aquaculture with water use, in water use. It's basically, you know how usually they say water use is like 70%, in agriculture 70%. Armenia is half of that is now comparably is aquaculture. So it's a huge fast growing sector, and we had all the issues of not circulating, basically taking fresh groundwater every time from deep water wells, which is a horrible problem because, you know, we even have problems in hydroelectricity production because our deep water wells are losing pressure. Now, how do we, is there a practically feasible, you know, roadmap or a transition? Can we somehow make this happen, basically? It's a very big question, but
I thought about it a lot. The good thing in Armenia is that the water is not salty, right? So basically a lot of these problems that we encounter because of the salt water, we don't have at all. Mm-hmm. I think, and I don't think we have to discover anything new here. I think we can just go back and use the systems. There should be some pressure. Like, you can never make a farmer to spend money. Like, unless there is a big, I don't know, political, governmental pressure, I don't see anything changing. But basically, you can implement like three simple reactors, like two. You don't even make to make biogas reactor. You can really use this thing as a fertilizer. I mean, the microbiology is a bit icky. I've been checking before. But all in all, like, you don't have salinization problem. I think what we could do is basically get rid of nitrogen. And there are so many systems. Like, I wanted to talk about what I did, and what I did was a step ahead, right? But there are so many systems all over the world that do this minimal water treatment, which is ammonia oxidation, which is also not that, I mean, you have to pump this thing in this big reactor, which you can make yourself. It's just tube. And the one we had in Baltimore had like arms again, like this propeller type, and it just moves very slowly, and these beads are there, and then it's open to air. You really, like in this case, you need this reactor and these two propellers, but electricity, of course. And from that on, like the cheapest thing I have seen, and that's what happened in the university I was working with our students, for denitrification, they were like, what the hell, like, seriously, like, you buy molasses and you don't know how to... They took this entire reactor, it was horizontal, if you noticed, it wasn't vertical. And they basically pump, put it, like, they fill it with cotton, regular pharmacy cotton. And they would just pump it through it slowly. And when it comes out, it's clean. It's just like, there was nothing really... My feeling with Armenia is there is no enough pressure. Like, in Baltimore, like this system, now they made a startup company, not the university because, but some very rich guy that has already many companies. He made a startup company to sell this that we worked on to people. So, but it's possible to, with fresh water we have much less issues.
You can also do the north. You can start from both ends. You can try to do from the business interest, but also norm setting, government pressure.
Yeah, I think the problem is also in Israel, like, there is still no environmental laws officially. Like, the farmer whose fish died, he really didn't care. And the problem was, what happened is, like, he lost, I don't know, $1 billion operation forever, because it's expensive. Intensive systems are very expensive. But the one that we worked with, he was just curious and interested and kind of cocky. Like, he was a very interesting person. He had peacocks in the farm in the middle of the desert and these huge dogs that he was scared of. But for him, this waste treatment was something as cocky as this peacock. You know, he was like, I'm treating waste. And they were making it's isolated place, so he had the gas cylinders to feed the workers were generally this young teenagers that kind of want to run away from parents. So they live there in the tents and they cook on the stove. And they would also make their omelets on this gas. Like, we would go in the morning and they would like, do you want some omelet? Do you want some fish? On the gas that we produce. But it was more his personal, it wasn't his farm, he was a manager, but it was his personal thing. I think wherever you don't have laws, but technically it's completely possible, and in Armenia I think it should be much, much, much easier than with the salt water generations.
My question is, in fact, continuation of that last portion of the discussion, and is related to the possibilities to make this kind of purification economically feasible, for which I understand it is necessary, as Astrine mentioned, to have some kind of regulations, some kind of norms that are, for instance, charging for dumping certain types of chemicals, heavy metals, or whatever it is, or nitrates, etc. Is there any experience in the world in this regard?
I don't think aquaculture.
Well,
I might be wrong.
It's not only aquaculture. Anyone, you cannot right now dump, for instance, acid into the river at the moment. You cannot do that. You will be fined for that. The same things can be applied, and if there is that kind of fine, then all of a sudden that kind of purification systems may become economically attractive.
Generally, when I publish a paper, I have to justify why I spend all these years on this thing. And so as far as I published the last paper 2 years ago, but as far as I know by that time, there were basically no rules or policies. What was growing more was awareness. It was like more of an awareness thing than a punishment issue. And awareness came because aquaculture started becoming more and more and more. Before it was much less and nobody cared. Like, okay.
But if you're in the competitive market, awareness, well, may attract some your customers to whom you say that the fish that you buy from us is not polluting the environment, and they will buy, yes, but that will be smaller portion of people that will buy them. But if you impose that kind of fines on the pollution, then all of a sudden everyone will start. Yeah. Everyone will start.
I was, when I was in Baltimore, I met an Armenian group of delegates from some ministries, and my childhood friend was friend was there accidentally in the middle of New York, and we're talking. And then he said, Nada, do you want really good job in Armenia? And I said, yes. He said, no, I can make a law of aquaculture solid waste treatment. And I was like, it just landed me in 30 seconds from New York, Manhattan to Armenia. Like, I was like, wow, that's basically like only for me, being an expert and making money, you could make a law. But I was like, no, if you make law, you make law. But then nothing happened, but it was like a coffee table conversation. So, but it also woke me up in the sense of understanding how the laws are sometimes made in third world countries, unfortunately. But I personally do not, maybe there are some countries, but I don't know any country that has such a strict laws on these things yet.
Thank you. Any questions from our scientists?
Yeah, I have a question. Was there in your project any component related to study how adding of this new component influences production cost of a fish?
Basically, what happened in Baltimore, the biogas produced, the electricity produced, it covered like 17% of the electricity.
17?
Yeah, it actually gave some more money to the guy who was producing. 17. Yeah, 15 to 17. I can send you three papers or two. One, this one with Baltimore, and there was a lady that by the end of my PhD, she published two papers, which was saving for me. She is an engineer from Norway. And she had these continuously stressed reactors, and because of it, there was all the time she was asked to do the mass balance and justify the price. And she also, I think, she covered 3 to 5% of her system energy. So it's not that this extra system didn't take energy; it actually produced enough to cover that one and a bit more. This I remember. This fish was actually sold really cheap. I don't know exactly why, maybe because there is no market, but it was like, I don't know, 5 times cheaper than maybe other way they would buy it.
And the second question, did you study experience of Danish Salmon Company, which is also a land-based facility on production of salmon in salt water, and they also have this biogas production?
What happens is apparently I'm the first person who has PhD on this solid waste treatment in the world. So generally when there are articles coming to the reviewers, I get them to the publication, I'm the reviewer. So I basically more or less know anything that is published. I can say that I dig much into industry because it's really deep. Like if you go to the World Aquaculture Society conference, like it will be 60,000 people and 30,000 of them will try to sell your system, which is really good, but you sometimes cannot even choose. So this I don't. But if it was published, most probably I know. This is the Sur woman, you know the name?
I don't know the research, I know the company.
You guys visited them in Denmark?
Yeah. Most probably I don't. But the
scientific field I do. Anyway, it should be related to Danish Technical University.
I actually reviewed two papers from them. But what I could see with solid waste, the rest I don't know, they are really starting from zero. Like it's, there is some time to get there. Like two papers I reviewed, I let it pass because I thought we need a field, but I didn't see anything really new in it yet. So I don't know. But again, you can use your traditional methods, by the way. I mean, you don't need to go in. Like with the nitrogen, you can use the method that people use for 20, 30, 40 years and are okay. You don't need to do anything really too much for liquid waste.
What I'm also noticing in looking at your pictures, this is not, the most expensive component is the human component, right? This is not quantum physics.
Yeah.
It's not. You need a basement, right?
Yeah.
And that's, I guess, the most expensive component. The real estate is the most expensive. Unless there's plastic kind of containers and pipes and you connect, and then there's the human investment you need to make into your expertise.
Like in Baltimore, there is, in the staff, there's like, I don't know, two senior engineers that like know everything about these systems and all scientific literature. If you need a paper, you cannot find, they would have the copy of it. these two guys. And then there are like 7 or 8 engineers that come and go or stay, and there's a lot of physical work in this. Like, as a scientist, I just go and try to sample this reactor without falling inside it, because that's like certain death. And that's it, like, that's all I do, right? For myself. But there is always people, there is always work done, and there is always a huge engineering mind incorporated in it that you would not do without them.
Overwhelmed to be asking questions intellectually.
But
no,
I am.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalia. This was a great treat for all of us.
Yeah.